In this video, I'll briefly summarize how initiation of DNA replication occurs in E. coli, and then talk about how the process is regulated such that initiation does not happen again until an appropriate time. E. coli has a relatively small circular genome of about 4.6 million base pairs and a single replication origin. The origin contains several AT-rich repeats where unwinding occurs during initiation. Adjacent to that, it contains several binding sites for the initiator protein DNA-A. Also in this region are quite a few GATC sequences that are recognized by the enzyme DNA adenine methyltransferase, or DAM methylase. This enzyme adds methyl groups to adenine bases in the sequence on both strands. Now this fact will become important in a few minutes. The conditions that trigger initiation of replication in an E. coli cell are still being investigated. It seems to have something to do with the total cell mass. When the cell grows large enough, that encourages replication. But also the amount of the initiator protein DNA-A in its ATP-bound active form is important. When it has bound ATP, DNA-A has a relatively high affinity for the replication origin. When enough DNA-A ATP is present, the small protein HU binds along with DNA-A, and together these proteins coil the DNA in such a way that the AT-rich initiation region unwinds. Then the DNA-B complex, which is the helicase, is added to the single-stranded DNA. And then the other proteins important for replication, such as primase, the sliding clamp, and DNA polymerase, are added to the helicase. Stimulated by the activity of the other proteins at the replication fork, DNA-A hydrolyzes its ATP to ADP at some rate, and when the nucleotide is converted to ADP, the DNA-A protein dissociates from its binding sites. In this ADP-bound form, DNA-A is unable to initiate another round of replication. So the length of time between initiation events is controlled by the rate at which DNA-A hydrolyzes ATP to ADP and the rate at which the ADP can be exchanged for ATP to reactivate the protein. This figure summarizes regulation of replication initiation by nucleotide exchange in E. coli. The central circle is the bacterial genome. As noted above, when replication starts, the rate of ATP hydrolysis by DNA-A is increased. This is called RIDA, or regulatory inactivation of DNA-A. Also, when initiation has occurred, the protein IHF promotes binding of DNA-A ATP to the DAT-A locus on the genome, which contains several DNA-A binding sites. Binding of DNA-A to these sites promotes hydrolysis of ATP to ADP. Both of these processes, RIDA and DAT-A binding, convert DNA-A to its inactive ADP-bound form, preventing reinitiation of replication. IHF also promotes binding of DNA with ADP bound to it to the two DARS sites. Binding at these sites causes DNA-A to release ADP. It also seems that binding of DNA-A ADP to negatively charged phospholipids promotes release of ADP. The free DNA-A is then able to bind to ATP again, converting it back to its active form that can participate in another round of replication initiation. Furthermore, newly synthesized DNA-A prefers to bind ATP rather than ADP. So the point is that as time passes, active DNA-A will accumulate in the cell again. But these processes of ATP hydrolysis and ADP release take time and create a period during which DNA-A is unable to cause initiation of replication. Another mechanism contributes to delaying replication initiation. Recall that DAM methylase adds methyl groups to GATC sequences at the replication origin. Now, immediately after DNA synthesis, the newly synthesized DNA will not have these methyl groups added, so one strand is methylated and the other one is not. A protein called seq-A binds specifically to hemimethylated GATC sites at the origin. When seq-A is bound, it physically blocks DNA-A ATP from binding to its binding sites at the origin, preventing reinitiation of replication for a period of time. After about 10 minutes, dimethylase will completely methylate the newly synthesized DNA, at which time CKa dissociates and DNA-A-ATP is able to bind again once it reaches a high enough concentration. Having gone over the mechanisms of initiation control in E. coli, I'll move on in the next video to talk about regulation of initiation in eukaryotes.